In all you've seen.
All right, well, this is Stranded, the Australian Canadian Music and Talk Show, and a special interview with a band that has sold out their Vancouver concert. They're on Network Records. The band is called Boy and Bear, and I'm joined on the line with Tim Hart, drummer from the band. Hi, Tim.
G'day, how are you?
Very good. I was just looking at your website, and I'm guessing you're speaking from Edmonton. Would that be right?
That's correct. Pulled up at the front of the hotel, and pretty soon we'll be going down the sound check.
Oh, fantastic. Spent some time living there in Edmonton. Is it still horrendously cold, or is there a bit of warmth?
No. It's beautiful. It's been cold everywhere else, but it's like 67 or something. It's unseasonably warm, we're told, but it's really nice.
So, like, is it still snow, or is it, like, actually sunny? And
It's sunny. I mean, there's a bit of snow on the sidewalks, but yeah, it's a spring day.
You're very, very lucky, because it's a brutally cold place, but I can imagine how nice it is. I remember this time of year. Fantastic, Tim. So is this your first time in Canada?
It is. It's ironically, like we've had Canadian shows booked before, and it's never happened. And it's sort of taken us 5 years to get here, but it's been amazing to be in Canada, and the reception's been unbelievable.
Oh wow, that's an exciting moment for you. And just looking at your website, I could just see you're going to have a great time in the next few weeks. Do you know much? What do you know about Canada or Canadian music? Is there anything that you can think of, or is it just a completely fresh new experience, wide open?
I mean, obviously, like, you grow up listening to guys like Neil Young and stuff, and Gordon Lightfoot, and you know, like Canadian folk artists and stuff, and you know, Jonin. But the strange thing is, we had no concept of what the audiences would be like, and it's been very similar to Australia, like. People seem to really embrace it, and you know, we thought maybe they'd know some of the new record, but people have known the old stuff too. It seems like Canada is the sort of place where people make an effort to discover music by themselves, rather than just being sort of force-fed whatever radio or record labels are feeding them. It's been really cool.
You know, I think you're right there. You're the first person who's really put that into words for me, but actually I think you're right. And we have this strong network of college stations here as well. We don't quite have a Triple J phenomenon in Canada, so that does force music lovers to really search a little bit harder. So all credit to you.
People actually know the stuff.
Absolutely. I can think of one other guy, Kim Churchill, who we've interviewed here a few times. He's really put in some time here, and he's got a huge following now. Canada, so.
Well, that's awesome.
And how about, what was your experience at South by Southwest like?
You know, as you'd know, with South by Southwest, it's always pretty, like, whirlwind. We did 7 shows in 2 days, and we'd sort of just flown in from Paris, so it was pretty intense, but I think it was really worthwhile for us. Some brutal parts, though. Like, we had an 8 o'clock start one morning. We were playing a live-to-air radio at 8 in the morning, and that's not fun for anyone, but I think it was just sort of about getting through it and doing the best job we possibly could, and like I said, yeah, it was just a whirlwind.
From my vantage point here, I can see year after year there's more Australian bands that seem to be making their way. Can you recall any that you particularly bonded with or that you'd recommend to the listeners?
Obviously, like, I'd always recommend Jezebel, but they were good friends of ours when we were first coming through, and remain so. Actually, we were supposed to be playing a show with them tonight in Edmonton, but they had visa issues, I think, in the States, so they had to postpone the tour. I'd recommend them, definitely. I'd definitely recommend Rufus. They're a great Australian band that are coming through, and they're fantastic. And we played just before Rufus at one of the... We played a showcase called Aussie Barbecue, which was cool, and, yeah, they played after us, and... They were fantastic, and we know them from back home in Sydney Boys too. So yeah, those two acts.
Okay, thank you. And I just want to go right back to when you first formed in 2009. I know the band started out with Dave as a solo project, and eventually the band formed around him. I wonder if I'm really curious about how that process sort of played out. Being myself as a beginner singer songwriter, showing up to open mics and stuff, and I think a lot of us, the dream is something like that will transpire, that you'll meet the right people and it'll become bigger than just a one guy. And can you recall, you know, how that all played out for you?
Yeah, I mean, so Killian, myself and Dave were all frontmen of our own projects, and I myself am a folk guitarist sort of first and foremost, and what happened is Dave needed some help on some stuff, and Killian was filling in on guitar, and I'd just been travelling overseas for a year and I'd been to uni with these boys, so when I came back, our manager was also the drummer, and he was doing a fair bit of work. I think he was going over to work on the College Music Journal at CMJ in New York. They needed someone to fill in on drums, and I filled in, and we started writing together, and it just felt more like a band than a solo project. And so Dave eventually, well, after about two shows, he sort of made the call. He said, do you want to make it a band? And we were like, yeah, it feels really good. And it was actually really fortunate for us that it happened that way, because things started to move quite quickly thereafter.
Fantastic. And yeah, it just seems like such a natural, organic thing, and it that you genuinely like each other's company and like each other's music. It's brilliant.
Yeah, they're good blokes.
Yeah.
I don't think you could do the sort of travelling we do and be with wankers, so
yeah.
We're pretty fortunate, I'm constantly amazed by the fact that we still want to hang out with each other day in, day out after 5 years now. It's incredible.
Yeah. And on Wikipedia it says, I'm just going to read out, it says that their songwriting usually has Hosking strumming chords on a guitar, Gavin writing the hooks, and Hart providing backing vocals, lyrics, and drum lines. Has this changed in any way your approach? Is that still fairly typical of how things happen with songwriting?
Yeah, I think it's dependent on my song, but yeah, that's about right. I think everyone's quite, I'm just trying not to be a tosser, but everyone's got a few talents, so like in terms of being able to play a few different things and ideas, and I think everyone sort of will come up with hooks and with whatever at the time just to serve the song, and I think that's the great part about it. There's not a whole lot of ego involved, so if someone's got a good part, then you listen to them, and so John, like my brother, he was the lead guitarist for my old project, and yeah, he definitely writes some of the hooks and signs. Yeah, our bass player is fantastic. He's a producer in his own right. So, we're in a pretty fortunate position where, the other four blokes in the band are really, really super talented and it's very collaborative.
It's interesting to see how things transpire over the next number of years, because that's a really good way to start out your career.
Hopefully they keep going.
Yeah, well, and definitely looks like you're going to make some new fans here in the country. Just going back now to how a lot of people first heard about you with the cover you did of Fall at Your Feet by Crowded House. Like, whenever I'm doing a show here, like, I kind of assume I'm doing this show to people who... younger people who might even know who some of these bands are, and like, why were you inspired to record a Crowded House song, and why should anyone care about who Crowded House were, like, as a band?
It's incredible. When Paul McCartney was asked by a journalist, how does it feel to be the best songwriter in history, and his response was, why don't you go and ask Neil Finn? I think that kind of speaks for itself. The Finn brothers are iconic for Australians especially, and they're wonderful songwriters and great performers, and we actually got asked to do the song as part of a project called He Will Have His Way, which was a whole lot of male Australian artists covering Crowded House and Tim Finn songs. Neil and Tim Finn songs, and it was sort of just an afterthought for us. We did it because it was a great honour, and didn't expect anything to happen from it. But it ended up being a really great thing for us, and it continues to be. Although we don't play it live at the moment, I think we played it to death a little bit, and we've sort of moved on from that for now. Mm. But it's been wonderful how it's been received around the world, and I think Neil sort of. He was a really big fan of it too, which was a real feather in our cap and quite overwhelmingly humbling. And it's been a cool thing. I think I'd encourage any young person to get into Crowded House. If you like good pop songs, like, no better way to start.
Yeah, that's right. Like, I'd never heard that quote from Paul McCartney. Thank you for mentioning that. That's amazing. And also, listeners, his son as well, Liam Finn.
Liam Finn,
yeah.
Yeah.
We've played his music on the show here, and I'd recommend checking him out too. He's quite brilliant. Getting back to then where you progressed musically from there, is there one song in particular or like that you could say is your proudest moment so far of your, not even necessarily your singles, is there anything that jumps out for you personally, your favourite Vorian Bear moment?
I literally just think getting to the end of this album, the Harlequin Dream album, and being happy with every single song that went on it. I mean, for me, actually, bar one, but we won't talk about that. although I'd be happy to tell you. It was a really great process. It was a long process, and I can listen back to it. I know a lot of artists have trouble listening back to their own music, but if someone's playing a record of ours, I can listen to this one and be proud of it. And that for me is a really wonderful thing.
Oh, that's great. And I know that there was a little bit of tension around one of the videos that you shot for the album that you filmed in the Philippines just before the typhoon. Did you want to say a little bit about that? Because I know that there's some awareness raising that can happen around fundraising.
Yeah, definitely. Well, it was 2 weeks before the typhoon hit, and actually the part of the Philippines that we filmed in wasn't hit, it wasn't affected, but we thought it was important, seeing that we'd filmed a video there and it was going to be released, that we do our best to raise awareness. And of course, you want to be sensible to the people, sensitive to the people of the Philippines. But we thought it was important to do something. So we obviously directed people at the end of the clip toward the relief effort, and you know, sort of partook in that ourselves. I think, you know, whenever you make a piece of art, it is art of itself. But if you can be of any help to people that need help, then I think that's important too.
That's right. Well. Thanks for mentioning that. There's it looks here online that UNICEF, Oxfam, Australian Red Cross, people can still donate to those charities for the relief effort in the Philippines. So on your website too, you're doing like a regional tour, hey, when you get back. And I just saw the city I grew up in, Gladstone. And like, is it a pretty rare thing for bands to, like, it seems like it's such a cool thing to do, and do bands put in the effort like you're about to do to play these smaller places? Like, or is it something you're excited about? Or
yeah, we're really excited. I mean, since every release we've done, we've made sure we've toured regionally. It's really important for us. Number one, like, a lot of these guys don't get a lot of bands coming to their town, so they have to go to a capital city. You'd know yourself to be able to see live music that is a, you know, that you're hearing on the radio or whatever. And it's been really important for us to support the regional communities, and you can't get to everywhere every time, and still we're not this time, and there's people we're missing. But you know, I think more Australian bands should do it. But the fact that they don't means that you know, like when we come to these places, everyone comes to the show, and
yeah.
It works out well for us too, because we get to tour Australia a lot more than we would if we just did capital cities. And so I think it's a win-win, and it's been a great model from the start, and we'll continue to do it for the rest of our careers, I think.
Well, that's brilliant. And just a little favour, life will be hectic for you between now and then, but if you do remember, you're playing Gladstone and you're on stage and it pops in your head, just maybe mention to the crowd that there's a guy in Vancouver, Canada, and he does an Australian music show, and he grew up in your town, and he has fond memories of Gladstone.
Yeah, all right, I will.
Thank you.
No, just to thank people that are coming out to our shows and listening to our tunes. It's really overwhelming for us to be here in Canada and to be received almost like it's our second home. It's really nice, and we hope people continue to enjoy it, and we'll keep trying to make good music. I hate you sometimes.